Hola, hola. ¿Cómo están? Pues como ven, este panel va a estar con muchos expositores. Está muy interesante porque es una serie que se llama City Island. Es una serie de animación que se estrenó este año en PBS Kids. Que PBS Kids es como la televisión abierta en Estados Unidos, pero no tan chafa como la de aquí de México. O sea, aquí, la de allá sí está chida. Y hacen contenido para niños educativo y de muy buena calidad. Y esta serie es una de ellas. Y está aquí casi todo el equipo, bueno, no todo el equipo porque es enorme, pero bueno, las cabezas y varios importantes ahí del equipo. Los voy a presentar uno por uno. El primero que va a pasar es Aaron Augenblick, creator of City Island and owner of Future Brain Media. Vamos a darle un fuerte aplauso. También está Adriano Schmidt, Head of Content de PBS Kids. Un aplauso. También está Carlos Gagiola, CEO of founder de Demente Animation Studio. Está Katie Wendt, Animation Director of City Island. Jeremy Yusei, Background Director of City Island. Sophie Lozano, Rigging Supervisor of City Island. Y Lexi Kehanovitz, Writer of City Island. Oigan, un anuncio antes de empezar, nada más rapidísimo. Todo este panel va a ser en inglés. Ya saben que ahí están los traductores, los aparatitos para aquellos que prefieran tener ahí, estar conectados y se los traduzcan solo con una credencial. Y pues nada, sin más, los dejo aquí con este increíble panel y espero que disfruten mucho esta conferencia.
I'm gonna stand for a second. Hello, hi Pixelottle. Hola. Gracias, this means so much to me to be here with City Island, which I'm so proud of. I'm Aaron, I created the show, and it's a show for PBS Kids. And so we're gonna talk about how we made the show today. And the first thing we're gonna do, in case you haven't seen City Island yet, we're gonna show you a trailer. It's super quick, it's only like a minute. We're gonna go through the whole process. I'm gonna show you the trailer, we're gonna talk, I'm gonna introduce all these people, and everyone's gonna tell you about what they do and how we make a cartoon. I'm gonna try to give you good information and keep it fast enough that I want to do Q&A at the end. I really want to hear your questions, so that'd be great. So thank you again, gracias for having us. And the first thing we're going to do is watch the trailer.
Well, maybe.
Gracias. So, I'm going to take you through everything, and we have a whole process here of the way we make City Island. So, the first thing with City Island is that it is a kids show for PBS, and they're 3-minute shorts. And I created it for my company, Future Brain Media. You may also know me, maybe you don't, maybe you do, from my company, Augenblick Studios. We have worked for over 2 decades now. We're in Brooklyn, New York. And we've done a lot of, mainly like primetime shows, a lot of things for Adult Swim. You may know Ugly Americans, Super Jail, Jellies. So we did a lot of more primetime shows, but always one of my biggest influences was kids shows, especially things like Sesame Street. Really meant a lot to me. Peanuts. These were shows that like changed my life, right? And made me who I am, and I always wanted to make a kids show. So when I started Future Brain about 5 years ago, I got together with my favorite creative people, including Katie Wendt, who we're gonna talk about in a little bit. And we just sat in a room and said, what's like your dream show? What's the kids show you've never gotten to see and you always wanted to see? And I said, I love cartoons, and I love cartoons where things are like alive, like cars are alive, or the window is talking to you, or there's a, you know, shoes that are alive. I like anything like that, like Roger Rabbit or Fleischer cartoons. Those are like my biggest influences. And I've always loved it, but I never got to make a show like that. So I was like, what if we made a show that's about a living city where the city was the show, right? There's no humans at all. The actual city itself, like I said, the cars, the objects, they're the living city. So that's what we made. So I created this show. And one of the first things when we, like coming up with the idea was, oh, well, if it was a show where there's a living city, there could be like a little light bulb and his name could be Watt. And he could glow when he gets good ideas. It was like the first thing we said. And I think the second thing we said is, oh, and his best friend could be a kite named Windy. And that's the show. It really kind of hasn't changed. So we made up this idea for this show where we would have a living city. And when I took it to PBS, there was a really cool producer named Linda Semensky that I talked to there, and she developed it with me. And she was the first one to say, oh, this looks like a show about civics. So that's City Island, and that's the show. And now, 5 years later from creating the idea, we're here with you at Pixelottle talking about the show. So we're going to take you through the process of how we make a cartoon. Does that sound good? All right. Do you like cartoons? Does everyone here like cartoons?
Yeah.
I love cartoons. It's my favorite thing. So, City Island. With all shows on PBS Kids, the most important thing is to make an entertaining show that has good, solid curriculum. We are all honored here today to have Adriano Schmidt, who is from PBS, and he's going to talk to us a little bit about PBS and how they treat shows and curriculum. Adriano.
Thank you, Aaron. So, as you know, you heard in the introduction, PBS Kids is the number one educational brand in the U.S. We are focused on kids 2 to 8 years old, so preschool, first years of elementary. We are in many different types of formats and platforms. We have video content. We have a games platform, which is an amazing platform we have, which is accessible here from Mexico. And so because this is animation and games, I thought I should mention that. But as Aaron said, every show that we create for PBS Kids needs to bring a specific curriculum. We want every episode to be able to bring to that kid a positive takeaway. And then that happens when you work with the producers and creators and you define the best possible curriculum for the show. And then you work with advisors that help you really infuse the jokes, the narrative, the arc, and all of that with the right takeaways. Our mission, like essentially what we say that we do is like, we like to show the viewer that the kid, that the world is full of possibilities, and so are they. So then we work hard on representation, we work hard on diversity, and we work hard on being smart, funny, and engaging. So In the case of this show, as Aaron was saying, when it was kind of like we felt that it married, the idea of a living city married very well with the civics curriculum. What is civics curriculum, and like what is civics curriculum for this type of audience? What we are saying is that basically, as kids start going to school, as they are leave that sort of the protective environment of their house, the protected environment of their house or daycare center or you know anything like that, they start to engage with the community. And then what does that mean? What is their role in that community as it relates to museums, libraries, you know, even like the mayor of the city. So it's to the idea of the show is to introduce all of that in a really fun and engaging way. And that's the foundation for later more serious civics engagement and learning, you know, about voting and about, you know, your rights and then the laws and the rules and the constitution and all those things. But you have to start somewhere. And then that entry to school is the best possible moment for a kid to be exposed to all of that. So that's kind of like where we are with the curriculum. And that's it. I think I kind of covered everything that I needed to cover. Thank you.
Love it. And Adriano is going to come back again at the end to talk about a little more about PBS and how people are watching cartoons now. Because we all know things are changing. It's pretty crazy. So PBS curriculum, next step, concept. That's what, lighting up. So a couple things I want to say. I should say at the top, so how many people here are from Guadalajara? Wow, okay, so like half of you. So I am so blown away by how much great work is being done here in Guadalajara. I've learned a lot of it with my friend Carlos, who's going to talk in a little bit. What's cool about this show, and we're going to get into it, I guess this is more of the concept of making the show, but I'll just say that, you know, it's a cool world that we live in that, you know, PBS is in Virginia, our studio is in Brooklyn, New York, and the animation is done right here in Guadalajara with Demente. So, pretty cool, right? So, I mean, one of the best things about the show is that, you know, I get to make my dream show, and I also get to work with, like, my favorite people, and it's so much fun. So, we're going to talk about that, too. So that's a spoiler alert that Guadalajara will be mentioned in a little bit. So, the concept of the show is that there's a living city. There's Watt the Lightbulb, his best friend, Wendy. The show is about civics, okay? Now, I went to school for animation. I went to School of Visual Arts in Manhattan. I when they said civics, I was like, oh, that sounds great. But I wasn't exactly sure what it meant. And then I read about it, and I was like, oh, this is all stuff I'm interested in. And now I'm completely obsessed with it. Because especially at this level, you know, one of the cool things about this show is it's not our world, okay? I don't want to get too trippy on you, but, like, it's not like our Earth, it's City Island. So like City Island is like our equivalent of like New York City, right? And Brickland in City Island is Brooklyn. So everything sort of is a metaphor. The whole show is a metaphor. Now what that allows us to do is to like be philosophical with the show. And it's the philosophy and the ideas of civics rather than just maybe like memorizing dates and names, right? It's about the philosophy of civics, which is so powerful for kids. We're going to watch an episode at the end of this that's going to be the culmination of how the process works. That's about points of view, right? The idea, it's a civics concept. I didn't know this. It's a civics concept that people can have different points of view and that not everyone has to be right or wrong. You can have different points of view where two people are right or both people are wrong. You don't know, right? That's a civics concept. Kids need to learn that, right? It's important to live in the world and understand that people can have different points of view. And so that's civics, right? So you think, oh, civics, oh, it's going to be about like memorizing the presidents. No, it's about real life. It's about things that we experience every day. So for us with City Island, with the concept, we created this living city that's about community. And that's another big theme of the show, is fostering an interest in participating in your community, doing things for other people, kindness, finding out who makes things work in your city. We teach about the subway. We teach about how does voting work? What does the mayor do? What does a postal delivery person do? We learned about what is it that makes a city and why are we all doing these things together? Well, it's because it makes life better when we all collaborate, and that's a theme of the show. So part of the show, you're going to see more of the show, is that there's a lot of characters. Like, we fill it. Another big influence is, do you know Richard Scarry? Richard Scarry? Okay, if you check out Richard Scarry, he's awesome. These were books I read when I was a kid, and he would do these big, and Where's Waldo? I like Where's Waldo. I love those dense shots where you see like a billion things, right? We call it organized chaos at the studio. So we love to have a lot of things because that's how communities are. Like, I'm looking right now, there's like all these different people and everyone has their own lives and worlds and dreams, right? So that's how our city is. So the fact that we have a living city, that means the mail truck is the one that teaches us about how mail works, right? The subway car teaches us about how the subway system works, right? So the city itself can speak for itself, which is really cool. It's also super funny. I feel like I haven't mentioned comedy, but it's also one of the things we're proud of at PBS is we're funny. And PBS is funny, you know? So the fact that, like, I'll tell you what, there's not many things funnier than Sesame Street and the Muppets. It's one of the funniest shows in the history of television, and it changed my life. And to be able to be in the home of Sesame Street and to be funny, to, like, make jokes like Oscar the Grouch and Cookie Monster is, like, kind of like an unbelievable dream. So that's the concept. I feel like going on too long. So that's the concept of the show. So next, after the concept, we have the idea for the show. Well, now we have to write the show. So we have the curriculum, we have a theme, say it's points of view. We know that we're gonna teach a lesson about points of view. We try not to use the word lesson because it sounds kind of dry, like it's not that good, but a curriculum, like a core curriculum, point of view. We know the concept, it's about civics, about community. Now we have to write an episode. So luckily, we have a big shot Hollywood writer here, Lexi Kahanovitz, who's an old friend of mine, and she was one of the first people called to write City Island, and she's gonna tell you a little bit about the process of writing City Island.
Yeah, absolutely, thank you so much. So once we have the theme, then we have to come up with a premise. So for a point of view, it was a premise where a few characters disagree about something that they saw. And how do they handle the disagreement? Do they storm off or argue? What happens? So once we kind of have that premise, then it's a really small group of writers. It's three staff writers, and then Aaron, and a writer's assistant. And we get together, and we brainstorm basically a plot. But the great thing about City Island is it's very funny people in the room, so we get to have a lot of make a lot of jokes, and yeah, it's basically just like one giant brainstorm, you know, where we will talk about dialogue, things like that, and then Aaron will assign the episode to whichever writer would probably best be suited to the episode, and then we write an outline, which is about a page long for 3 minutes, a 3 minute script. And then we send it out for review, and which gets approved with some notes that we then incorporate into the first draft. And then we all get together and do a table read, which is pretty unique for a kids show, and it's really, really fun, and it gives us a chance to hear like, what jokes aren't working or what could get punched up a little bit. So then we go and we do the polish and submit it to PBS, and we get your awesome feedback and incorporate that into a second draft. And then we send it back again, and then we do a final polish at the end. And then we kind of hand it off to the designers and to the voiceover actors. And that's basically the process. It's really, really fun.
So. Great. And nice. Round of applause for Lexi. Lexi, you want to tell them some of the other cool shows you've written?
Yeah, I was a writer on Frog and Toad, which is a really cute book. Thank you. Barney, which is coming out soon. Tom and Jerry, Pete the Cat. I've really had a lot of fun.
Big shot stuff, so. Hollywood writer.
If you have any questions about kids' TV, I'm happy to talk to you about it. It's a really fun job.
Wow, two rounds of applause for Lexi. I want to just add one thing that I think is unique. So how many people here are animators? Wow, you're my people. I love you. So it's rare, and I don't know if you've all experienced as animators, that you get to be involved in the writing, right? So as an animator myself, when I get to show run a show that I created, I'm there. I get to be there. And it was important to me to have my animation director, Katie, who's going to talk in a second, also there. Actually, really quickly, just do you want to add, being in the writer's room, what it is to be an animation director in the writer's room?
It basically means I get to do all of the fun parts without having to do the hard parts, where I just get to be there to kind of come up with jokes and ideas and like be in the room as we're talking about, like talking through the beats of the story. And then every now and then it's really useful because I can sort of like add a visual joke in. And honestly, it just sort of helps me like get the story in my brain so that I know what it's going to look like. And I can sort of start planning like what the animation can look like down the line. But yeah, it's super exciting and very honored that I get to be in a room with so many smart writers and so many cool people. And honestly, it's like a dream job because I just get to like have fun conversations and laugh for a few hours with like my friends. So it's awesome. Thanks for having me.
Well, yeah, and you know, I'll add also, you know, Katie's very humble because she's also a really great writer herself, and she's really she's one of those people that is constantly reading about writing and the philosophy of writing, and she turns me on to a lot of great books and YouTube. What's that one? They should tell everyone.
That's Behind the Curtain.
If you're interested in writing, check out Behind the Curtain. It's like directors and writers discussing their own writing process. It's super. Look, another thing about like creating is like you have to always be learning.
Steal from them. No,
steal from other people. No, but like seriously, like, you know, my studio's been open for 24 years and I feel like I'm learning more now than I ever have before. And I'm just like deep diving in everything all the time, whether it's like curriculum or writing or anything. So I just wanted to point that out, that, you know, with our writing, we approach it very traditionally. You know, sometimes animators have a love-hate relationship with scripts, right? We kind of, parts of our, like, oh, it's great. And then it's also like, you also want to just do crazy stuff that just doesn't have to have a story, right? And I like both of those things. But for City Island, it's the storytelling and the characters are so important. We approach it very traditionally. It's a 3-act structure. We're always talking about character arcs, motivation, story arcs, season arcs, like all that stuff that sounds super boring that you have to learn in school. It's actually not boring. It like frees you up to make like really creative decisions. So I just want to add that to the writing. So writing, we now have a script. We have an idea for a show. We have this curriculum for the show. We have a script for the show. Now we get to start drawing it. Super cool. So how many, if you haven't seen Gemma Coral, do you know Gemma Coral? Yes, we all know Gemma Coral. Yay. Okay, I'm seeing some Gemma Coral fans. She's she's like top 5 cartoonists working in the world today. Maybe she's number 1. She's my favorite cartoonist. She's so incredible. Gemma Coral, check out, what's her Instagram? At Gemma Coral. At Gemma Coral. Anyway, she's a dynamo. She's really talented. She's the nicest person you've ever met. Deep, super deep. She does a lot of really great comics about anxiety. If anyone out there is dealing with anxiety and depression, she does some, have you ever heard of, is there anyone out there that has anxiety? No? We all do. We live in the world. So she does a lot of cool stuff. Anyways, if you want to read about that too. So she designs almost every single character. And where's Sophie? We may talk about how many characters there are, because she has to rig them?
At least 480.
480 character rigs this season. So anyway, and Gemma pretty much drew all of them. So she does sketches for us. We pitch her the episodes. We say, this is what it's about. This is what we imagine they would look like. Sometimes Katie and I will sketch for her a little bit, so that's nice. That's nice to be a showrunner that can draw. It helps. You'd be like, well, you know, because like it's like, what does a wrench look like? And if you know, oh, we look at that, and then our hat is on the top, and the legs are, you know. So I can do sketches for her and stuff. So she draws the stuff, and she does. So if you look at these images here, she drew the one on top, and then what we do is we take her sketches and polish them for the rigs, make sure they're nice and animatable, make sure that the expressions are good. And so we just kind of, you know, do that polishing in the design stage. So there's characters, there's also backgrounds. City Island, what's that? And guess what? The backgrounds are characters too. So And you know, you should talk about that too. Just spoiler alert, rigging backgrounds. We rig our back. How many people here use Toon Boom? Wow. Okay, just for my own curiosity, how many people use Animate Flash? That's okay. All right, more Toon Boom. What about TV Paint? Wow. You two should meet each other. Okay, anyway, so there's characters and then there's also backgrounds. Now, for the backgrounds, Gemma does, sometimes she'll do sketches, but generally it's up to our team, and we're lucky to have one of my best friends as the background director. That's Jeremy Jusset, who's right here. We went to SVA together. We met because I sent him a fan letter, because he did a zine that I found, and I loved it, and I sent him a fan letter, and we met, and we've been working together ever since. That's a true story. And I think he's been working at the studio for 23 out of the 24 years, something like that? A lot.
22.
Okay, so maybe we don't know each other that well. So Jeremy is a comic illustrator. He won't say it, so I'll say it. He's an awesome book published by Simon & Schuster that's called The Strange Ones. So he's actually from the illustration world. How many people out there are illustrators? This is all just my polling. Wow, okay, great. So guess what? Illustrators are awesome in animation. I mean, you know what's good about illustrators? They can draw. So I always look for illustrators, and Jeremy can draw better than anyone I know. So, well, Jeremy and Katie both are the best. And so Jeremy's going to talk to you about designing for City Island.
Right. So so the process is pretty simple. It's we have a meeting once a week. We have four designers that we work with. I'm the background director. We have four designers who are all around the world. We have two in Philadelphia, and one in Belgium, and the other in England. So we all meet. Katie's there, Aaron's there, I think Gemma, Coral might be there. And then we discuss the episodes. So it's two episodes per week, and we just discuss the script. We go over Aaron's ideas, Katie's ideas of what these designs should look like. We assign two designers per episode, and then we say, go ahead, draw it. And then that's Monday. And then we let them do their thing. And we also have the design assistant in the meeting too. So the four designers go off, they do their thing, they use mainly Photoshop, and they make these brilliant designs, roughs. And then we use Slack to communicate. So we show all these designs, and then Aaron and Katie give their notes, revisions, and then I contribute as well. And then they come back and make those revisions, and then there's an approval process, and then once that's done, it goes to the design assistant, and she converts it from Photoshop to Harmony. And we don't really do like super intense rigging. We just, and you should know this, right, Sophie? We just we did basic rigging, and we left like the cool stuff to you. And then, and I think that's it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's it.
We have a color palette that helps too.
Right. We have a very simple, basic color palette based on Gemma's colors that she usually uses, and that gives the show like this unified look.
Yeah. It's not that many colors. It's only a few dozen colors, and like that's another thing. I'm going to impart lots of wisdom today. The another thing, artists get scared of limitations and rules. They're not bad. They're your friend, because the fact that we have a simple color palette, it frees you up. It makes it have a very consistent look, right? It has a very, very, like if you look at a page of City Island stuff, it just all feels good together. If you can use unlimited palette, it just ends up getting like too much. You know what I mean? So we do that to ourselves all the time. Our line weight is very, very regimented. We have rules about our line weight, our colors, everything. So and that's how you keep design consistent. Because people always ask that, right? do people ask that to like family members? Like, how do you get everything to look the same? You know, and it's like, it's because it's a lot of rules, you know, to get it to look the same. Okay, I really am hoping to do a Q&A, so I'm gonna expedite by combining thumbnails and animatic. We have designs, we have a script. We now start thumbnailing and doing the animatics. We do ours in Flash, because we like it, and we do Harmony for the animation, but we do all our animatics in Flash. One of the things that is important to us is, you know, I like the creative process to be pyramid-shaped, right? I like to have a very small group of, like, very, very hyper-talented, like, superhero artists at the top, and then that sort of, like, a lot of the decision-making happens at the top with just a couple of people, like, literally, like, two or three people, and then you add people as you go. That way, all the big creative decisions get to be made by the people that, like, are sort of the most qualified to do it. So what I like to do is I like to have the director, Katie, thumbnail. So she thumbnailed about half of the episodes herself and while doing all the directing. It's insane. So I'm going to hand it off to Katie. So if you could kind of combine thumbnails and animatic maybe. Cool. Katie Wen.
Thank you. On the thumbnail pass, I'm working with the script and with a radio play. So we have the voice actors record the voices, and sometimes we have like music from our composer, Tunde Adebimpe. If anyone knows TV on the radio, he's incredible. So I'm working with this audio script that is exactly 3 minutes long, and I don't have to time out the thumbnails to them, but it's basically like these, you can see these like here, is these super rough drawings. Actually, I didn't do these thumbnails. This is like our other thumbnail artist, Brian Weaver, who's an amazing illustrator himself. We actually find that thumbnails coming from illustrators and comics artists are really amazing because comics artists are so good at visual storytelling. It's basically like getting to be the director of photography for the show, where you're deciding how the characters are placed and you're blocking the action. And like Aaron said, it's a lot of like intense decision making about how everything's gonna sort of like sit and look. Like this episode specifically, I know we had to like decide like, okay, like these characters are sitting around a table talking to each other. When do they talk? Who needs to be sitting next to each other? How clearly do we need to see them when they talk? Mark is like up here writing in his journal the whole time, so where does he need to be so that we can see that happening? It's a bunch of interesting decisions. And then the thumbnails are given to the animatic artists who are also working with the audio, right? Oh, he's so cute. But, I didn't even realize it moved. Wow, okay, that's cool. But but the animatic is then timed to the audio as well. And we have obviously like these incredible vocal performances from our voice actors, Kimia Bipornia, who's Watt, Kimiko Glenn is incredible as Windy, and a lot of our other characters, if anyone's seen like Into the Spider-Verse, she's Penny Parker. She's huge, she's amazing. I think she's also Baby Shark, so you got Baby Shark, I know. So then, basically, the animatic goes through a lot of passes. We get notes from that from PBS on the animatic to make sure everything's working clearly, to make sure it's funny, to make sure it's not moving too fast, just fast enough. And yeah, I mean, once that gets approved, then it rolls into animation stages.
Yes. So now we have an animatic. And by the way, another thing I'll say is
rigging too. It happens, I guess. But yeah, it's all happening at
once. These are 3 minutes. So one of our biggest challenges is, you know, there's a sweet spot between being fast-paced and slow, right? So it's like, you want to not be too fast that it's going to be, like, too insane, but you don't want to be slow either, right? So it's like, I'm always happy when people say, like, oh, it was pretty fast, but it was great. Like, I understood it, you know? Because when we did the pilot, we had to experiment. Like, I think the pilot was actually too fast, you know? So, like, pacing is so important, and that's just something you get the more you do, the more you time things. Watch movies, by the way. I'm sure you all do already, but I'll just say, like, we're just constantly, like, watching movies, animated movies, live-action movies, watching the pacing, watching the editing, thinking about pacing, how much time you need to absorb things, you know? So anyway, the timing of the animatic is very, very important. And we also, as animators, you know, you don't want to animate stuff that you're not going to use, so we try not to be too fat. You know what I mean? Like, we try not to make the animatics too long. So they're just, like, a little long. We can trim a little bit, but not too crazy.
5 seconds,
maybe. Like, 5 seconds,
max,
you know?
It's
because
like,
we know how hard it is to animate, and I don't want to have to have people. And honestly, we can't afford it either. So so animatics are nice, tight. Now, all packaged up, ready to go to Guadalajara, to Demente. Woo! Woo! Round of applause for Demente in Guadalajara.
Yeah, we love Demente.
So the first step in animation is rigging, and we are lucky to have Sophie here to talk about rigging.
Okay, so now that we have the animatics, we have to inspect them and analyze them thoroughly, but really, really thoroughly. How many characters are there? What does each character do? Because it's not the same to rig a main character that's going to move a lot, that needs different joints, that needs different parts of the body. Ooh. Okay, this is our main character, what? As you can see, he has a lot of controllers because he has all these expressions, lip sync. We had to separate the leg, the arms and the legs in two parts because if he had to cross his arms or anything like that. This is Windy, she's also a main character. She was tricky because she's a kite and she's flat. But we rigged the characters to make them
flexible?
Yeah, as flexible as possible to kind of mimic frame by frame animation. You can see the animation is very, very fluid here. So we tried to adapt the rigs to that. And so the main characters are more complex, but we had to do hundreds and hundreds of extra characters or secondary characters. So we had to analyze what do each character needs. What are the needs of each character? Because there are secondary characters that need a lot of movement. Like if you recall a slide ago, there were like these three books. Those three books talked and moved and jumped and did a lot of actions that most of background characters don't do. So we had to separate their arms as well. We had to give them lip sync. In this case, for City Island, we had the privilege that we already got the files from Harmony with all the pieces separated. And what we did was like tweak them and add the rigging, the deformers. If we needed some extra, we added the blinks to the characters. If we needed some kind of expression, we added that as well. So yeah, it was what I did was I had a team of riggers, and each Friday we had a no not each Friday what day were the Mondays we I don't remember, but there was a day of the week that we all saw the animatic together. Once we saw the animatic on Friday before we started the week of rigging, I did a whole list of what views all the characters from the episodes we were working were going to need. So this character needs three quarters front, the other three quarters. This character needs to walk. This character needs to speak. This character, it's only a background. He doesn't do anything. So we're just going to make a basic rig so he can just stand there and maybe blink and be cute, and that's it. This character moves a lot, so we have to make sure that all the parts of the body are well separated. So yeah, it was a very individual experience for each rig. And we also had to make sure that when we pose them like this, to make sure that the rig worked for what it needed to do. So yeah, we did a lot of rigs. It was a great team effort. But yeah, it was amazing. And what else? I think that's it for rigging.
Woo! Sophie. So I'm gonna... teamwork is a good thing to say because, I like that Sophie pointed that out because one of the important things to me, because I'm an animation studio, right? And we typically do most of our work in-house, and in this situation, we're working with this awesome studio, Demente, as a collaboration. So when we looked into this pipeline, it was important to me that it wasn't just a handoff, that it would be like an expansion, right? That we would all be working together as one big collaboration, right? Because I've seen productions where they just like send them in the mail and then you get them back and then you go, oh, this is wrong and what, this is right. And it's like, for me, it's so important for everyone on the, I think that everyone that works on a show or a movie should know why they're doing it and like it and be motivated to do good work. They should be passionate. I truly believe you can see passion in animation. You can tell when the crew was into it, when they were psyched, when they were like inspired by their director, right? You can see it, it's there, right? And it's like, and things were like, you know, there was a kind of a night, we probably, how many people have experienced a nightmare production where it was like, oh, terrible, it's tough. Okay, give away people. We've all had it, you know, and there's a lot of reasons for that. It could be the budget was too low, it was a difficult script, whatever. It's difficult. So to me, I want everyone to be happy, and I want to have a big family that makes, I know it sounds corny, but it's true. I feel like we're a big family. And what's so great is a long-winded way of introducing Carlos, you know, to talk about animation. Before I do that, though, I do want to have Katie talk a little bit about the inspiration and what she was looking for in the animation, because she worked very closely with the team, and she'll talk a little bit about that. And then we're going to hear from Carlos.
Yeah. So for the inspiration for the animation, obviously Gemma Coral's art sort of like led the charge, but I have always, it's kind of crazy to me that I'm an animation director, because I always like basically just wanted to be a character animator. I loved Disney character animation. I love high quality animation. I feel like when I was a kid, I could tell when like it was a little bit like phoned in on shows for kids, and I don't think that kids deserve phoned in animation, and I don't think that animators, especially like a team of extremely talented animators like Demente, deserve to like feel like they don't have the time to make the animation like beautiful. So we were basically just really inspired by Fleischer, like the old classic animation where we tried to do most things on twos, you know, 12 frames per second. When we could, we would do ones to make it like extra fancy. And yeah, basically just like strong performances. We really like tried to give each character their own sort of like the vibe and personality and let it shine through. And honestly, like the rigs, because the rigs were so incredibly strong and versatile, it was so easy to do. It was like a real pleasure to work with. So yeah, I mean, working with Demente was amazing. So Carlos.
Thank you, thank you. Well, thank you guys. thanks. Yeah, definitely. Well, likewise. It's has been just a few times that we have the pleasure of collaborate in this level. Of course, it has been a great process of communication first. Like any great project, we have a very good communication almost every day, having our weekly meetings, reviewing meetings, checking all the animatics of every episode. So the communication, I think, it was the key, and we did a great team, for sure. It's great pleasure to, this is something that we don't, it's not that you usually work at this level of confidence and friendship. So it has been an amazing experience, maybe the best that we have since we opened. So also, after having the rigs created, we dedicated a couple of teams of animation completely independent with their own supervisors on each team. So every team was running like a, yeah, like an escalator, like a, you know, like desfasado, I don't have the face. So after that, we internally did the layout, but we will, because the schedule, we showing to Katie when we have the keys already for showing. We did a revision of kids, and then we jump into the process of the full animation, have another revision step. And after that, after being approved, everything goes to compositing. So yeah, more or less was the process of animation in the studio.
Yeah, thank you so much too for like, yeah, communication was, I mean, it sounds like so obvious, but communication is so important between the two studios. And it was just, it was extremely important to me because I would give notes on the keyframe animation and on the final animation that was coming from Demente. And as I gave notes, it was just incredibly important to me that every artist felt like they were bringing their own unique creative voice to the project. Every animator at Demente and every artist at Demente, I wanted them to feel like they had their own creative input and were like a unique creative voice in the project. You couldn't replace any one person. Every artist like brought something really special to the project, and I think it shows in the final animation. It was just, yeah, it was always really fun to like see the animation start coming in and be like, whoa, this looks so good. Like, it was, yeah, it was awesome. So thanks, Carlos.
Yeah, no, you're welcome. And also I want to remark the important, the importance of our production team, you know, our project managers, our producers in Demente, transcribing all the notes, having everything from shot grid to the every animator explaining, touching base again with New York, the team in New York, going back. So it was a, yeah, it's a really good synchronized dance.
Let's do more.
Yeah, for sure.
Next up, finishing. So there's a lot of things in finishing, and I think that this is a good time, since it's kind of the wrap-up. It's the wrap-up of animation, and then it's also the wrap-up of our presentation, to mention that every process that we just saw is seen by PBS Kids, is looked at very, very closely, and they give us all of their thoughts, everything we do, every single thing. Nothing happens in the dark, right? From the scripts, the ideas, the original ideas, the outlines, the scripts, the animatics, the designs, the animation, every single stage goes to PBS Kids and they give us their thoughts. And I am being 1,000,000% sincere in saying all of their notes make the show better. And that is absolutely 1,000,000% true. I'm so, so proud and happy to be working with PBS Kids, because nobody makes higher quality kids programming than PBS Kids. And like I said, from Sesame Street when I was a kid to all the amazing shows now, from the Kratt Brothers to, you know, Daniel Tiger to, there's just a million, you know, all these amazing shows, Eleanor, Pinkalicious, these, I could just go on and on. They're great shows because they're entertaining and they're educational, right? And they have an actual nutritional value while still being fun, right? So it's like the dream. It's like a, it's like candy that's good for you. So anyway, I just wanted to point that out. We have an amazing producer named Gavin Langford, who is like the one that kind of we mostly directly deal with, and he kind of combines a lot of the comments from everybody at PBS, from curriculum experts to producers to educators to you know, writers, like everybody at PBS gives their thoughts, and it usually goes through Gavin. And I also have to mention Sarah DeWitt, who's at the, you know, at the top of the network, and she's doing so many amazing things, which I'm gonna have Algerno talk about in a second. So I'm just saying that good producers make good shows, right? And PBS is just like the best at it. So I just wanted to point that out. Also, now let's talk about the nerdy stuff. After Effects, we use After Effects, and we put all of our, all the shots that we get from them, they send us the shots, we put it through After Effects. That's where we put a lot of the texture. We like to look like watercolor. We have like effects and things like that. We do sound design ourselves. We love doing sound effects, sound design. Katie mentioned earlier, we have one of the most brilliant musicians alive today. His name is Tunde Adebimpe. He has a great band called TV on the Radio, and he does all of our original compositions. You heard his song right there. I love the comment, I think it was on Reddit, somebody said, why is this preschool show song a banger, right? And it's like, and it's good, the songs are really good. So it was really important to us that this music felt like City Island, it felt uplifting but cool, you know? So we have music, we have sound design, we have After Effects, we edit, we put it all together in Premiere. You guys like nerdy stuff like this, right? I'm a nerd, so I like to give like specific stuff. So, woo! So Premiere, After Effects, and we put it all together, render it, and right from our studio in Brooklyn. So think about that. We wrote it in Brooklyn. We, you know, we have curriculum from PBS in Virginia. We write it in Brooklyn. We do designs. It goes to Guadalajara. It gets animated. It goes back to Brooklyn. We do the finishing. We do the sounds. We do the thing. And then we send it back to Virginia to PBS, right? And then now it's ready for kids to watch it, right? Now, another thing about PBS, not only are they great at making shows, they're also really great at
having shows that people watch and showing it to people, right? Because nowadays, it's true, people are like, oh, how do I see this? I don't know, I get a thing, I gotta download this app. PBS is great, they know it's important to them, and Adriana will say much more deeper things about this, but that it's important to them that kids can see these shows, because the whole world needs to see these shows because they're educational, and there's places in the world where they don't even go to school, right? All they have for their education is PBS, and that's incredible, and it's moving to me. So PBS is so good at finding out how kids are watching things and targeting that. So I'm gonna hand it back to Adriano, who's gonna talk about PBS and basically how things are being seen.
Yeah, no, I'm gonna be really quick about this because I think that we wanna watch a cartoon, right? We wanna watch an episode. So basically what we wanna do, and you know, that's no surprise to any of you, is that we wanna be where kids are. We wanna make sure that kids everywhere have access to our content. We started as, you know, a linear network, a TV channel, as, you know, some of you may remember. So we have that, and we actually have two of them in the U.S. One is the general audience one, where in the morning we show content for kids, and another one where it has kids content 24/7. But we know that's not enough, that kids want to watch it whenever they want to watch it. We have a video app where kids are able to watch shows on demand. And we have a games app that I mentioned before, where we have more than 300 games available to kids with educational component connected to the show, to each one of the different shows and series that we have, right? And we are on YouTube as well. So I think that between YouTube, our website, pbskids.org, games app, video app, and the linear channels, we pretty much cover a lot of the different outlets out there, right? So we premiered City Island on December 26th of last year, so it's been less of than a year, and it was, you know, a huge success. We've had, in our video app, we've had 60 million views of the episodes. Remember, these are 20 episodes only, so we only have 20 episodes, 3 minutes each, 60 million. On YouTube, it's been viewed by 2 million. We've had 2 million views on our channel. It's basically available only in our channel. So, you know, and that I think you can access. The video app you cannot access here in Mexico, but the YouTube you can. And so the results were so great that we're happy to announce and to say that we're doing a second season with all of these wonderful people here. So, yeah, we're so excited to see what Lexi and everyone in this this panel will come up with for a second season for Watt and Wendy and the rest of the gang. So anyway.
Thank you, Adriano. By the way, we always get good feedback from Adriano as well, because he has seen maybe more movies than I have. He knows about everything. He knows about architecture. So we always get great feedback from Adriano, too. Okay. Thank you.
Are we about to show the episode?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, wait. Right,
so
before
here's
we show
what we're
it,
do.
I have one last poll to give. Okay. So we asked already, I think, who does illustration and who does comics and who does animation. Who here doesn't work in animation at all? You just like cartoons a lot. Yeah, thank you for being here. Gracias, muchas gracias. Okay, cool,
so
thanks.
We now
just wanted
know
to check.
Who all of you are. This is good. So we're gonna watch a finished episode. This is the culmination of that. It's only 3 minutes, so we should be able to watch this, and I'd love to do some Q&A. I hope we can do Q&A afterwards, because I would love to hear your questions. So this is it, City Island Point of View.
Written by Lexi.
Written by Lexi. Lexi wrote this episode. Everyone here worked on this.
Yeah, we'll make it right on City Island.
Thanks for having us over for a sleepover, Lydia.
I've never been to Hopeville before. All the neighborhoods of City Island are so different.
I think we should hurry to your house, Lydia. It's getting dark.
Don't worry. I know a shortcut.
Whoa! Oh, what is that?
Let's get out of here!
I'm way ahead of you!
What was that? Wendy, get the phone. We need
police.
Why would we call the space police?
Because of what we just saw. Don't you remember?
It happened just like this. The sky was getting dark, so we bolted to Lydia's house. We turned the corner, and there it was, plain as a bagel with no cream cheese. A UFO! A real alien spaceship.
But I didn't see an alien spaceship. I saw something completely different. Golly, the sun was going down, but Lydia had a swell shortcut. Jeepers, that's when I saw it. A great big tornado!
No
way. I didn't see
that.
It wasn't a spaceship or a tornado. I'll tell you what really happened. We were hurtling across a darkened landscape when I found a shortcut. As we spun around the corner, we witnessed big glowing eyes. We were face to face with a monster!
That's a fun story, but it was definitely an alien spaceship.
Does anyone want to know what I saw?
No!
Sorry, Spokes. What did you see? No, I don't want to tell you.
I saw the tornado!
Hi, kiddos. Want some cookies?
Yes, please.
This is ridiculous. There's no way we saw totally different things. Who is right?
I believe I have the answer.
What did you see, Mark?
I know one thing. Arguing won't fix anything. We need to listen to each other and check the facts. That's why I wrote it all down. Let's go investigate in the morning. Also, it's way past my bedtime.
This is a lot less scary in the daytime. There it is!
The corner.
A UFO-themed car wash?
We were all wrong!
Actually, you were all right in your own way. The UFO that Watts saw was the neon logo of the car wash. The scary glowing eyes that Lydia saw were the headlights of a car getting a bath. And the tornado Wendy saw was a scrubber.
Whoa! Mark, you were right! When we checked the facts and listened to everyone's point of view, we got a better picture of what happened.
Then my job here is done, which is good because my dad is picking me up in 10 minutes.
Thank you. I've never stared at a room of people watching it before. It was awesome. Everybody seemed to really enjoy it. Thank you. Gracias. Can we do Q&A?
Two questions.
Okay.
Please, por favor, levanten las manos, dos personitas. Tú y hasta el fondo, la chica de hasta el fondo de allá.
Hi. My question is, how do you walk the line on writing for kids? Like, make it understandable to them, but at the same time, not treating them like kids, like treating them like persons.
Thank you. You know what? I find I actually, I don't interact too much with kids. So I find that I never try to talk down. Really, the only limitations I find are, there's just so many jokes that you can't really use that are a little inappropriate. But it's actually a really fun limitation to have because you can have really good, wholesome jokes. And again, like sort of having the inspiration point being or a foundation of education within it is a really fun way to work. Because again, it's a limitation, but at the end of the day, you feel really good because you're writing something that kind of puts good values out there. So yeah, I don't really find that there's too much of a difference between adult and kids. It's really just a limit on what jokes you can use.
I just want to add also that as far as like, with the kids thing, because it's true, it's like, I'm happy that we're making a show that makes us laugh. And we are in the writer's room laughing like crazy, enjoying ourselves. It's never like, oh, we're just making this for somebody else. We're making it, it's watchable by kids. Obviously, it needs to be safe for kids. But really, we're trying to make a funny show, and that's really, really important, and it's sincere. It's very, very sincere. And I think sincerity in entertainment is important. And like also, I, again, made like adult, like primetime stuff for like two decades. I scratched that itch.
You know what I mean? And it's like sometimes people like they try to like sneak stuff into kids' shows. Oh, I'll put this in there. It's like I had zero interest in doing that. I've done all the Adult Swim stuff. That's fine. That has its own world. But for me, the fact that we can make a show that is genuinely a positive show, it's genuinely optimistic, it's genuinely good-hearted, right? It's a show about kindness, right? I feel very like touched by that. It's important to me. So I feel like when you have a good intention, it sort of forms the sense of the show, right? And you tend to not do stuff that isn't going to be good for kids because you don't want to. Why would you? You know what I mean? So it's like kids have enough to be afraid of. They don't need to have to like see stuff that's not right for them. You know what I mean? So we want kids to like watch this, laugh, hopefully be inspired, you know what I mean, and learn a little bit. Like, so it's just sincerity. It's something I'll add.
And my last thought on it is like I think it's really important when you're making stuff for kids to like I really try to remember what it was like to be a kid and remember how much I hated when people talked down to me and like when someone's like, okay, this is the lesson, you're just like, even when you're really little, you're just like, so like I try to avoid that as much. We try to avoid it as much as possible. And honestly, like I'd say it a lot in conversation is like, it's our job as older people to remember what it's like to be a kid. It's not a kid's job to know what it's like to be an adult. So we try to always, you know, kids are people. Kids are smart.
One more? One more? Can we do one more? Oh. Who else? Who's got a question?
Hello.
Oh, back there.
Yeah. So my question is kind of related to the last one. I was wondering, like, the shows and the topics that you include, like, might and probably will impact the kids' lives, like, permanently. So how do you, like, filter the topics that you put in the show and, like, the whole process? I mean, you work all together and you discuss these topics, and we like do have shows like Oye Primos, like they, no one like tell them this might be racist, you know? So
sure.
Yeah, I was wondering.
That's a great question.
Yeah.
That's a great question. So I'll say that's a great question, and there's a name we haven't mentioned yet that's crucial to the show, and that's Anne Lund, who's the head of curriculum at PBS. And she does an absolutely stunning job of exactly what you're saying, being very, very careful about, they create basically curriculum guides for all of the curriculum that shows, whether it's math or science or reading or civics like us, or now they're getting into media literacy, which is very, very exciting. The arts, performing arts. So she and her team create very, very concise and clear guides for us producers about what you can and can't talk about and what's the right age range, what are like, they're very, very careful about what's appropriate for kids and what's the best topics to be covering. And that's the, when we started like with the curriculum in the beginning, that happens first. Number one, it is not the opposite. It is not, we don't just get in a room and go like, let's create some funny ideas and then we'll figure out what the curriculum's gonna be later. 1,000,000% no. Like, we start with the curriculum, we have conversations with Anne, we have conversations with our curriculum advisor, Liz Hind, another great name who is crucial to the show. Liz Hind is our curriculum advisor. She looks at everything. We have long conversations with her that are so fun and inspiring, talking about social studies, geography, civics. We talk about things that, like with POV, she goes, oh, you know, what, this concept that, like, you know, there can be different points of view of the same incident. And I was like, oh, wow, that's like my favorite movie, Rashomon. Does anyone know Akira Kurosawa, Rashomon? There you go. So again, inspiration, watch lots of movies. So I was like, oh, that's like Akira Kurosawa. We could do our version of Akira Kurosawa on a show for 6 to 8 year olds that haven't seen probably Akira Kurosawa yet. So we did this episode, we're like, well, that'd be funny. They could like all see the same thing and they all think they saw something different. And then at the end, it becomes the same thing. And what if it was like Watt thinks he sees his UFO because Watt loves science fiction. Oh, and Wendy sees the thing, she's kind of like a little bit like Wizard of Ozzy. So she could see like kind of like a tornado, you know? So that's where, so you see how it works, right? You have a career, you have an idea. And then everything, it's almost like I don't know, like the icing on the cake is all the funny stuff, you know? So you have a very, very solid base, and then all the funny stuff comes later. So I don't know, Adriano, do you want to say anything about
curriculum?
No, just two things I think that are important to both of the questions. One is that in terms of the writing, in terms of everything that we pack on the show, we feel that it's important that in the way that the kids consume this content nowadays, that they will want to watch it again. They will want to watch it again and again and again. And then having sort of all these different jokes and different visuals happening at the same time is just like something that we know that is going to work in that way, that you know the kids will want to watch POV again and again. And in terms of the messaging that we have there, we are also making sure that the content itself has the educational part of it can be easily understood by kids depending on their different ages. But then this is like more for kids to 6 to 8, their starting school. So we make sure the vocabulary we use is addressed to that demographic. And you know, I think that in terms of the topics and in terms of the curriculum, you cover it all, Aaron. So really happy with the way that the show can introduce so many interesting ideas to kids. We hope, you know, even it's going to be useful and fun for some adults as well.
Thank you. And I will say, if you are new to City Island, you know, there's a lot of, like Adriano said, there's a lot of ways to watch PBS Kids. A quick one is pbskids.org. You can always see all of their awesome shows there. We also have an Instagram, City Island PBS, on Instagram, at City Island PBS. And we post all kinds of, like, you know, art and, you know, holiday stuff and some process art and sketches and things like that. So check that out too. But definitely check it out on PBS. PBS is everywhere. Watch it. I'd love to hear what you think. You can write us through our website and, you know, check that out too. Either futurebrain.com or also augenblickstudios.com. You can do that. And yeah, I just want to say, gracias. You're amazing. This meant so much. And thank you. Pixelato.
Thank you so much, guys, for being here, for sharing all this amazing work. Unfortunately, we run out of time, but thank you so much for having you here. It was amazing. Thank you for sharing your work. And let's give a last big applause for them. Recuerden que la salida es para la derecha. Ahora sí, por favor, ahorita ya no se acerquen acá con ellos porque estamos un poquito presionados de tiempo para la siguiente. Así que aquí los esperamos, ¿vale? Muchas gracias.